Good morning. Good to see each of you here today. Pastor Neil normally would be up here leading our service for us today, but he's a bit under the weather, so I have the privilege of filling in. I want to begin, first of all, by welcoming each of you here. It's good to have John Yarbrough here. We just got the chance to visit a little bit, and looking forward to the message God's laid on his heart to share with us today. But we're glad you're here. If you're a guest with us, be sure to fill out one of our visitor's cards and give that to one of the ushers or place it in the offering. We're glad for you being here with us. We're glad for each of you here. Trust you've had a great week. And let's stand together. I want to read just a short passage of scripture and then remain standing for our prayer, and then we'll go right into our singing this morning. I'm reading from Psalm 145, a song of praise by David, in which he says, "I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable." What a privilege, isn't it, to be able to gather today to lift up, extol, and to bless the name of our Lord and God and our Savior Jesus Christ. And it's not something we just do on Sunday morning. As David says, every day is our opportunity to worship and to praise him. But I'm glad for today, aren't you? Glad that we can gather here to join our hearts and our voices and our minds and all that God has made us to be in our worship of him today. Let's pray and then let's sing as we praise the name of our God and Savior. God, we thank you for the great privilege we have to join together here as we worship you in spirit and in truth. God, we would lift up and extol your name and bless your name forever and ever. Lord, what a privilege it is to worship you. You are great and greatly to be praised. So Lord, accept the sacrifice of praise we bring to you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. God's love is amazing and his grace is amazing. Please sing with us.
You lay down your life that I me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Welcome everyone once again, and glad that you're here with us. Indeed, it is God's amazing grace, isn't it? We're so grateful for that. Where are we at here? I've lost track. I did things out of order. This is what happens when you get the rookie up here. All right, so we welcome the guest, pastoral prayer. All right. Hopefully you all got a bulletin when you came and take note of announcements. We'll call attention to a few of those things a little bit at the end of the service today. This Wednesday is the last Wednesday of the month of June, and we're going to have our kids program. We've got our Wednesday morning study. We got our Wednesday night study. But then we're taking a break for the month of July. All of the Wednesday activities will be on pause and resume back in August. So be aware of that, and we'd love to have you out for that. I don't know of any other announcements we need to make at this time. And so, again, let's just bow for a moment of prayer. God, thank you. Thank you for the privilege again of being here with us today. And we just give you our praise. Thank you that you are our mighty fortress. You are our God and our King, and we just count it a great privilege to worship you this day. So, Lord, continue to be pleased as we offer up to you our praise and our thanksgiving this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together again and sing as we offer God our prayer.
God is our mighty fortress. Hearing all the news, even today, the truths of this song are still true today as it was when this was written. Sing with me.
A mighty fortress is our God. A bulwark never fails. We our own strength confide. Our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side. The man of God don't choose. You ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is He, the Lord of hosts, His name, from age to age the same. And He must win the battle. World with devils filled, should threaten to undo us. We will not be, for God hath will His truth to triumph through us.
See that out.
And through this world with
like.
church and save souls.
All right. Yeah, there is no one like our God, indeed. And there's still a lot of work to be done, isn't there? Last I checked, there are people all around us, people you know, people I know, people we come in contact with every day who need to know the Lord. And why has God placed us here? Why does he keep us here? To take that message of hope and salvation into our world today. He's the God of this city, and there are greater things still to be done. I'm grateful for that. At this time, it's our time for giving back to the Lord. And have our ushers come forward just to remind you of ways to give. Obviously, you can give in the offering. You can give online as well if you choose to do that way. There's also an offering box back in the foyer that you can use on your way out if you haven't done so already. So as we go to this time of worship and giving, let's again unite our hearts in prayer. Father, thank you. Thank you for the privilege to be able to give back to you. You're the one who owns all things. Everything we have is a gift from you. You've called us to be good stewards. And in the stewardship of our giving and our worship of you through our offerings, this gives us the opportunity to carry out the mission that you have called us to in this great city, to bear the good news of Christ here in Lawrenceville and beyond through the support of our missionaries, that all over the world you would continue to do your great work. Lord, we know that your word does not return empty or void, but always accomplishes what you've purposed for us. And you've promised to be with us as we go. And so, Lord, help us to be faithful and not just giving our money and letting that be it so others can do the work. Help us to join in as you enable us to be able to carry the message of Christ wherever we go. Thank you for the privilege of being able to give today. Be pleased with this sacrifice we bring to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Faithfulness.
Thank you, worship team. Appreciate your ministry and music to us this morning. Well, let's have the kids line up. It's time for our children to dismiss to Kids Club. So, guys, just hang out there for a second. I want to pray for you before you go. It's good to see you. I've missed you all this week. You know, last week we were so busy with Vacation Bible School a week ago. And great to see you all. I hope you all had a great time. I hope you're excited to learn some stuff today. You going to be nice to your teachers back there? Yeah, they look a little questionable. All right, let's pray. God, thank you for our children. Thank you for the opportunity that they have to be a part of our church family. We just pray your blessing upon them and their leaders. Help them to learn much about you in the time that they have together. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Great to see you guys. Have a blast. All right. As they're heading out, I want to introduce to you our guest speaker today, John Yarborough. Come on up, John. I just got a chance to meet him very, very briefly. But the first thing I noticed, he has a wonderful lapel pin on his jacket with an American and a Ukrainian flag. And well, you know how dear Ukraine is to my heart. I asked him about it, and what his connection was. He said, I'm just a concerned Christian, which is a great thing to be praying for Ukraine. And if you follow the news, and we were talking about how quickly things drop out of our news. We have a short attention span in this country, but thousands of people a day are still being adversely affected by the war in Ukraine. And even overnight, I heard about bombings in the city of Kyiv, as well as the conflict on the border. I checked in with a couple of my friends in Ukraine who live in that area, who said, yeah, it was a horrible night, but they themselves were safe, and they said, continue to pray that God would bring peace to Ukraine. Well, I'm glad to have John here with us today and have him share God's message with us. So Lord bless your brother.
All right,
as you
thank
share.
Thank you. God bless you. Jesus Christ said that he would return. As a matter of fact, there is more in this book about the second coming of Christ than there was about the first coming of Christ. And he is coming back. I'm gonna ask you to get your copy of God's word. Turn with me to 2 Timothy, the third chapter. I'm gonna ask you to keep God's word open. We're gonna be looking at this chapter and describing how to survive and how to live in the last days. If indeed these are those last days. While you're finding that, 2 Timothy, the third chapter. Let me say I'm glad to be with you this morning. Amen. Been praying for you and praying for this time that we'd be together. And I have the opportunity to preach in churches very often and different churches and different times. And I introduce myself just as a supply. I'm just here filling in till you can get better. And I had a lady leave a church the other day, and as she was leaving, she said, you know, I grew up out on the country in the farm, and said, when we had a broken window, we'd take an old rag and stick it in the window as a supply until we could afford to get a pane to put in. And said, I want you to know this morning, you wasn't a rag, you're a real pane. And I'm not sure how she meant that, but I can tell you that I am glad to be with you today. But I believe with all my heart that the trumpeter is licking his lips, the shout is getting ready, and that you and I are living in the last days. Now, if that scares you, it wasn't meant to scare you. It's meant to comfort you. As a little boy growing up on the south side of Atlanta, my daddy would come home every night at 6 o'clock, not 5 till, not 5 after, but 6 o'clock. When I knew it was time for daddy to come home, I would get ready and I would be ready to run and jump in his arms when he walked in the door. And he always kept a piece of Juicy Fruit chewing gum in the top pocket that I could pull out, and he would take me to the supper table, and I had to put that Juicy Fruit down until after supper. Unless on those rare occasions my mama would say sometime during the afternoon, you just wait till your daddy gets home. Then all of a sudden, as it got close to 6 o'clock, I began to break out in a sweat as a little boy. I didn't go running when I heard his car pull in. I would hunker down in my room and sometimes hide because I knew that my mama, tattletale that she was going to tell him what I had done. It's none of your business, but tell him what I had done that afternoon. And I was in trouble. Now, if the return of our Lord scares you, there's one of two situations. You're either not ready to meet him, or you're a disobedient child that's afraid he's going to catch you and know what you've been doing. Now, I don't want to bust your bubble this morning, but I want you to know he already knows. I love to read church signs, don't you? You know, some church signs, they put their whole theology out on the sign. I saw one the other day. It said, Bible-believing, conservative, premillennial. But my favorite sign was a church that the name of the church was the Rapture Preparation Center. Get right for the flight. Well, this morning, if I could say to you, it's time for us to get right for the flight. And in this passage, now I believe in the inerrant, infallible Word of God. I love God's Word. I believe God's Word. I seek to live by God's Word. But in preaching in different congregations, I was preaching in a congregation that had interactive preaching. They would talk, not to each other necessarily, but while I was preaching, they would talk. And one of the things they'd do is if they agreed with it, they'd say, uh-huh. And you could hear that whole congregation sometimes just say, uh-huh. Now, I'm fixing to read this passage, the beginning in verse 1 of chapter 3 of 2 Timothy. And I want to ask you, would you participate with this visiting guest preacher? It may not be your norm. It may not be your context, but just kind of humor me a little bit. And if anything that I read out of God's Word, you believe that it describes the day and time that you and I are living in, would you punctuate that by saying, you got it. So if you'll have your copy of God's Word ready and follow along with me, I begin in the first verse. But realize this, that in the last days, difficult times will come. For men will be lovers of self, lovers of money, boastful, arrogant, revilers, disobedient to parents. Mom and Dad, can I get an amen? Ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, malicious gossips. Come on, Baptists, malicious gossips. I know we don't gossip. We just share. I want to share something with you. Brrr. When Paul wrote that, he had no idea that in the last days, the day and time you and I live in, there'd be an entire industry on malicious gossips. That things would be discussed and talked about on daytime television that shouldn't be mentioned in private, much less in public. That as you check out at a supermarket, there are all kind of publications that their only reason to exist is to tell you about other people's business that you have no business knowing about. Unloving, irreconcilable, malicious gossips, without self-control, brutal, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to a form of godliness, although they have denied its powers, and avoid such men as thee. Will you pray with me right now? Father God, thank you for your word. And thank you for your reassurance, for your promise that in the darkest of days, we can see that the end is near. And that your return is imminent. Father, I would pray this morning that you would burden our hearts, not only for our own preparation, but for our preparation of the people around us that they might know you and be ready when that great day comes. And Father, I pray this morning that the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart will be wholly acceptable to you, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Because it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Now, I'm going to very quickly this morning, and if you'll listen quick, I'll preach quick, and if you get through before I do, you let me know. But nail down very quickly three things out of this chapter that if you and I are going to live in the last days, and your has agreed with a text that it does seem like it's describing the day and time that you and I are living in the basic culture in which you and I survive. And one of the things that he says right in this first part of this passage is avoid the pleasure seekers. Avoid the pleasure seekers. And everybody says, amen, amen, amen. I tell my kids not to run around with those folks out there. And the Word of God says in 1 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the 33rd verse, bad company corrupts. And we certainly want to avoid the pleasure seekers, not avoid reaching them, not avoid talking to them, not avoid sharing the gospel with them, but avoid hanging out with them, avoid trying to be. Sometimes the church tries to be so much like the lost world to reach the lost world that the lost world doesn't see a difference in the church and the world. There's no separation. We're to be a peculiar people. Now, some Baptists take that a little bit too far sometimes, but we're to be different. There's supposed to be something unique about us. But avoid the pleasure seekers. But I would challenge you this morning looking at that passage. That he's really not talking about avoid the pleasure seekers out there. He's really talking about avoid the pleasure seekers in here. Holding to a form of godliness, the word says, check me out, but denying the power thereof. They're not holding to a form of godliness. But sometimes we're holding to that form of godliness. We lift up our church membership. We lift up that we're doing good deeds, that we're this. But we deny the power of God. There's no power. There's no evidence. There's no transformational life. There's nothing that separates us from what's going on out there, holding to a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. I'll never forget, years and years and years ago, in a political campaign when Jimmy Carter, do y'all remember Jimmy Carter? Was running for president. He made the statement that he was a born-again Christian. Everybody was up in arms. What does that mean, born-again Christian? Southern Baptists, by the way, at that time, it's not anymore, but at that time, we were one out of every 20 people in America was a Southern Baptist. But Walter Cronkite, you remember him? Didn't know what being born-again meant. So he brought Bill Moyer in to explain to him and his viewers what it meant to be being born again. When Bill Moyer got through explaining it, I wasn't sure I remembered what it meant to be a born-again believer. But then there was another, and I won't mention his name, man running against Jimmy Carter for the nomination of president. And he said, I'm suspicious about any man who speaks about his religion outside church. Well, I want you to understand, Vern, I'm concerned about anyone who doesn't speak about their faith outside the church. Amen. Holding to a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Avoid the pleasure seekers. Don't be a pleasure seeker. You may be a pleasure seeker this morning, holding on to that form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. You say, well, Brother John, we're here this morning. We're here in church. Listen, Vern, just sitting on a church pew doesn't guarantee you're a Christian any more than sleeping in a garage makes you a Buick. There must be a transformational act that occurs in your life when you have repented of your sin and professed your faith in Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. And then there's a whole lot of things that happen. But in the last days, in the difficult times, avoid the pleasure seekers. But number two, go with me down to number two, verse 10 of that third chapter. But you, Paul, writing this letter to Timothy, his protege, but you follow my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance, persecutions and sufferings such as happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord delivered me. And indeed all. Is that what your word says? And indeed all. I studied real hard to know what all meant. You know what all means? All. Everybody. And all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. It's not what the preacher told me on TV the other day. He said God wanted me to be happy, healthy, and wealthy. And that if I just send him $1,000, God would bless me. Listen, I want you to understand, Vern, the one who will be happy, healthy, and wealthy is the guy you send the $1,000 to. God's word says here, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Well, Brother John, I'm not being persecuted. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. The winds of persecution are blowing around the world. Our brothers and sisters are being executed. Many are imprisoned. Many are ostracized, and the winds of persecution are beginning to blow stronger in America than we've ever seen them against the Church of Jesus Christ. Easy believism are going to be days of the past. It's going to cost to follow Jesus. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus. Well, as I look in that passage, you know, I begin to realize that the persecutions come from three different sources. First of all, there's the satanic persecution. Satan, old Scratch, doesn't love you, doesn't care about you, doesn't give a flip about you, but he wants to destroy you. He wants to crush you. And the satanic attacks, you know, every once in a while I'll have somebody come, Brother John, Satan's attacking me. I said, well, tell him to stop. Greater is he who's in you than he who's in the world. If Satan is having advances in your life, it's because you're allowing him to have advances in your life. But you see, he can't go against God because he did go against God, got him sent out of heaven. So what he does is like the bully on the playground, he goes after what God loves, and that's you. God loves you passionately. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, and you're a whosoever, I'm a whosoever, believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. That's how much he loves you. He gave his only begotten Son. Satan hates you. And if he can crush you, you say, well, what? I'm a Christian. He can't have you, but if he can distract you, if he can burden you so that you take your eyes off God, he can take his unholy fist and shake it in the face of a holy God. So the satanic attacks come. Do you know what? I read the old preacher, Vance Havner read, it's one of Vance Havner's great quotes. If you hadn't run into Satan today, you better watch the way you're walking. You must be walking in the same direction. I almost welcome the satanic attacks now, knowing that I'm invading his kingdom. Because, see, the Word of God says the gates of hell will not prevail against us. Now, I don't know anybody that's ever attacked me with their gates, but their gates are always to keep me from getting into them. We're supposed to be attacking him instead of being attacked by him. And the more you attack him, the more angry he becomes about you. So there's the satanic attacks. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Satanic attacks. But then there's the secular attacks, and our culture is becoming more and more secular. Less Christian, more secular. And the secular attacks come. That's when, you know, you can, late night television, the comedians can make fun of Christians. We're not one of those groups you can't make fun of. They don't understand us. They don't understand what we do and why we do it. They can't understand why we pray. They can't understand when we call for people to pray. And you know, I've got to say, the secular attacks, they just don't understand us. And I say, bless their heart. Now, if you're from the South, you understand what bless your heart means. It means you don't know dirt. And we can just smile and say to somebody, bless your heart. They smile back because they don't understand what we just said. They just don't know. There's a satanic attack. And there's the secular attacks. They're going to come. They don't understand us. But there's another area of attack that this morning here at Central Baptist Church in Lawrenceville, if we could declare it over, it's the sacred attacks. Vance Havner once said, we're the only army that shoots its own wounded. I believe we wound our own walking sometimes. When people need us the most, they run from us often because they don't want to be the blunt end of our criticism and our gossip. Instead of running to the church, they run from the church. Just when their life's up against the wall, just when they're falling apart, just when they're hurting the most, and we begin to attack one another. Well, they didn't do what I wanted to do. They didn't sing what I wanted to sing. They didn't go where I wanted to go. I was preaching at the evangelism conference in Idaho. And they did a unique thing, Pat. They rented the city auditorium and they held the evangelism conference there. And at night, they invited the city to come. And their director of evangelism said, now, Brother John, tonight, we're going to have a lot of people here who have no connection to the church or to Christ. Just preach the gospel. I said, well, I try to do that. But God led me to preach just a simple plan of salvation. We offered the invitation, and scores of people came to Christ. The city auditorium wasn't an altar, but it became one that night. And I don't know about you, but when God's moved, when things happen, it's just really hard for me to go back to an empty hotel room by myself. So God's given me the spiritual gift of hanging around. And so I was hanging around in what we'd call the vestibule. And everybody, we were celebrating what God was doing, and there was a crowd. And all of a sudden, the crowd began to part like the Red Sea. And I looked, and there was a lady coming towards me, and I could tell from the expression on her face that she had the spiritual gift of criticism. Some of y'all think you found your spiritual gift, don't you? No. But I knew she was going to bestow it on me, and she did. She came, and she got this close to my face. Dr. Yarber, I didn't like that one little bit. Y'all had the drums up there. You had the guitars over there, and I didn't like it one little bit. I said, ma'am, we weren't singing to you anyway. Gang, it's not about you. It's about him. And it's time in the Church of Jesus Christ. The satanic attacks are going to come. I understand that. The secular attacks, bless their heart. But the sacred attacks must end. We can't fight in the barracks while the war is going on out there. It's time to unify before the church fossilizes. Well, avoid the pleasure seekers, anticipate the persecution, but there's one final thing. Go with me now to verse 14 of that third chapter. You, again to Timothy and to us, however, continue in the things that you've learned and become convinced of, knowing that from whom you have learned them. Now, Timothy, by the way, had learned from his mama and his grandmama. How many grandmamas are here? How many granddaddies? Boy, you got roles. You got a role. His grandmama and his mama. You, however, continue in the things you've learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you've learned them, and that from childhood you've known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith, which is in Jesus Christ. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. Avoid the pleasure seekers. Anticipate the persecution. And finally this morning, abide in the Word of God. It is important in every day, but especially in these last days, that we know, understand, and apply the Word of God. And how do we do that? Well, first of all, you have to hear the Word of God. You have to hear the Word of God. In hearing the Word of God, this church is in the process of seeking God's next man to be pastor. You want a pastor who believes the Word of God, knows the Word of God, and preaches the Word of God. Amen. It is totally necessary in these days to hear the Word of God. I used to have people tell me, you know, Brother John, I'm in a church and my pastor, he doesn't believe all of the Bible. And I would say, well, you be salt and light. You stay in there. You pray for him. You challenge him if he's out of the Word of God. Keep him in the Word of God. Keep him in prayer and keep that church. Now I say, go find another church. You say, you tell people to leave a church? Hey, it's too late to be wrong. We ain't got time to play. You got to hear the Word of God. And I want you to understand, there are some churches that are preaching God's Word in power and authority and strength, and seeing God do extraordinary things. His word will not return void. Seeing amazing things happen. So you got to hear the Word of God. But then you've got to heed the Word of God. God's word says to not be hearers only, but to be doers of the word. You don't just hear the word or study the word so that you know. You study the word so you do. These are instructions. This is the owner's manual. You know what the owner's manual is in your car? It's the most unread book in the world. If you've read your owner's manual in your car, two things happen. You've had trouble with your car, or you really need to get a life. But God's word. The reason some of us have trouble in our life is we're not following the owner's manual. We haven't followed the instructions. You got to hear the word of God. You got to heed the word of God. And I want you to know, God just really had work on me to get me to this third point. You hear the word of God. You heed the word of God. But you've got to habituate the word of God. It has to become a habit in your life to obey and do the Word of God. You know, my wife and I, we don't pray. Well, should we tithe this week or not? That's not a question for us. We're in the habit because we started years and years and years and years ago obeying the Word of God. We pray before meals. Do you pray before meals? It's a habit. We can't eat without praying. We pray in public. We pray in restaurants. We even pray at McDonald's. Now, I want you to know it's not as much for Thanksgiving as for mercy and protection. But we pray. It's a habit. As a pastor years ago, a family would miss 3, 4, 5 Sundays, and I haven't seen them or heard anything, and I'd give them a phone call, and or even show up at the door, knocking on their door. Fred, been missing y'all. Y'all haven't been to church in the last few weeks. Well, preacher, I guess we just got out of the habit. Got out of the habit. That's like if my wife, if I walked out this morning and didn't kiss her and she said, you didn't kiss me, I said, well, I guess I'm just out of the habit, honey. Well, once I got up off the floor, we'd have been able to talk about that because it is a habit. Matter of fact, she read an article a number of years ago that men who kiss their wives every morning before they left the house lived 10 years longer and made 25% more. She started puckering up twice every morning. But it is a habit. But it's a habit dug deep in love. Tithing. It's a habit born deep in obedience. Being in church this morning, not forsaking this self, assembling of yourself together is the habit of some. It's a habit. During the COVID, some of y'all feel like the weeks just kind of puttered by with churches that weren't meeting together. Yeah, you could watch on stream. You could watch them. But it wasn't the same. So in the last days, if indeed you agreed that those first verses of the third chapter describe the day and time in which you and I are living, then how do we survive? Avoid the pleasure seekers, anticipate the persecution, and abide in the Word of God. In closing this morning, can I ask you, are you ready? Are you ready? Were he to come this afternoon, the trumpet blow and the shout occur, and the dead in Christ will rise first. That's not the deacons. That's the cemeteries. And then those of us who are alive and remain to be caught up together with him in the clouds. Are you ready? You see, sir, I'm not trying to scare you. You see, ma'am, I'm not trying to scare you. I don't know anything in the Word of God that would keep him from coming today for his church. It's only the grace of God that gives us a little more time. I don't know whether it's going to be today, next week, next year. No man knows the day or the hour. Not even the Son, only the Father. But what does it take to get ready? To have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And to maintain that relationship with a walk with him. So that when he comes, you'll be like the little boy I was on the south side of Atlanta. You'll go running to jump in his arms. Or are you that disobedient child that when that occurs, you're going to hide your head in shame and say, I wasn't ready. I didn't think this was going to happen this way. I didn't think it would occur in my lifetime. Will you pray with me right now? Father God, you know each person in this room. You know each of us intimately. You know every molecule of our being. You have created us. You sustain us for a purpose. Something tells me that many of these in this room this morning have already come to that saving knowledge. They've placed their faith in who Jesus Christ is and what Jesus Christ has done. They've turned from their sins and turned to Him. And so, Father, I pray this morning, anyone in this room who has not, that today would be their day of salvation. But then, Father, some of us, we get so busy and so caught up in the things of the world. We've let things creep into our lives. We've not been busy about the things we need to be busy about. And Father, I would pray this morning that we would repent, that we'd return, and that you would restore our joy and our expectation, and that we would be anticipating that glorious return. And Father, I pray in these next few moments that you'd have your will and your way as we give you total liberty in this place, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me right now. We're going to sing together. And as we sing, this altar, I don't know what your customs are, but it can become a place of prayer and commitment. You say, well, why do I need to do that? There's something about that we don't need to know all the details of what goes on at the altar, but God does. But we're able to stand with you as you kneel before Him. Others of you, I'm going to come and stand right here. And if I can pray with you, if I can share with you how you can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're on your way to heaven, nothing brings me greater joy. Whatever way God speaks, as we sing together, won't you come?
My life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of
that message. Let's close in prayer. Our Father, again, thank you for your many, many blessings to us. Most of all, the blessing, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, even as we've been challenged today, we know that we're living in the last days. We're looking forward to that great day when Christ should come again. May it even be today, if that's your will. In the meantime, Lord, help us to serve you well, that you would take our lives and let them be holy, completely consecrated to Thee. Lord, dismiss us with your blessing. Go before us, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Just a few announcements before you head out the door.